Hello, Whitefish. I hope everyone had a great closing weekend on the mountain. Another wonderful season closed on an epic powder day. Great job to all the competitors at the pond skim. And congrats to Vinny Remmel for taking the title and his grandma's hand-knit onesie, no less. In case you missed it, here's a recap. Today's guest is Jamie Goguen. She is a local business owner and philanthropist. She and her husband, Michael, support a variety of ventures and nonprofits around the valley. We dive deep in this conversation, from helping the homeless, to affordable housing, to psychedelics, to her fabulous new restaurant in the heart of downtown, Herb and Omni. Jamie also opened up about her family's painstaking battles against a group of con men. Or is it con peoples, because there were women involved in the crime. Basically, a bunch of assholes tried to swindle them and got caught, and now one of them's in prison. Wah, wah. Today's episode is brought to you by Thrivers Coffee. If you would like to help support the fight against human trafficking, visit thriverscoffee.com to order your coffee and make a difference today. We'll get onto this topic, but having done my fair share of psychedelics, LSD was always my favorite psychedelic, but just the mind-blowing realization that we even get to exist. That's what was the big take, has always been the big takeaway for me. I used LSD when both my parents passed away from cancer. That was like a good way for me to kind of grieve instead of using the bottle, which like suppresses everything. Like I used LSD therapeutically and put on just like vinyl records, and LSD like helped me just like grieve and also kind of process what all that is.
Yeah, I think, you know, there's many sayings on this, but you have to go through the problem. You can go around, but you will never resolve that problem. It will just stay there unless you go through it. You have to go through, am I allowed to curse?
Mm-hmm.
The shit. Yeah. You have to go through the shit. And the thing about being on psychedelics is you can hear yourself. You can hear the God within you. You know what people proselytize about. And people can continue to proselytize all they want. But it's different when it's born in you and you hear it. Because it's a voice and a sound you cannot deny. It's a knowing that leaves a person with a tremendous amount of peace, you know? And I feel you. And so to be able to have even just the realization or wherewithal to think of that as an option over just putting it someplace, eating it, drinking it, shopping it, abusing other people, you know, just feeling the hurt constantly, that there's another alternative. I mean, I just feel like here's the solution that works for real people, real everyday people. It's extraordinarily inexpensive to produce. It is 100% non-toxic.
Physiologically, yep.
It like just isn't toxic.
Mm-hmm. Or addictive. I mean, it can be abused, but
everything can be abused. Mm-hmm. But for all, those of us that know, when you do a psychedelic, it's a strange, I don't know, I call it reverence,
mm-hmm.
where yeah. I do not want to do that for a little while. Like I'm
yeah.
good.
It's intense.
Yeah, it's because it's so powerful that you're gonna know stuff.
Right.
And you're going to hear stuff, and it's the stuff you need to hear. And once you process through and come out of the other side, what, 6 hours or so later, that you feel this sense of peace and understanding that you A, don't necessarily want or need to go do it again, but that doing so is good for, I guess, you know, some people have deeper work to do, and some of us can do it, you know, seasonally or, you know, after a couple of years or whatever, just to kind of re-up, I guess.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, it's very powerful. I've been reading a lot about psychedelics since before the pandemic. And then, of course, due to the pandemic, got to really dive in to some of the masters. And, you know, Paul Stamets is
the
godfather.
His little fungus hat.
Yes.
Yeah.
Of mushies. He's amazing.
Yeah.
But I've studied LSD and psilocybin, but I've only ever tried psilocybin.
Yeah. Psilocybin is great. It's something just about... I mean, you can't even call it plant medicine because it's not even a plant.
It's not. It's right. Of its own kingdom.
Yeah.
It's the fungi kingdom. Yeah. Yeah. But then LSD is a mold spore, isn't it? Or
yeah. It's lysergic acid. Ergot. Yeah.
Ergot.
Yeah. Because there used to be fungal, like a ergot wine, which is like a psychedelic wine that people used to drink.
Okay.
But yeah, I mean, it's a tiny, tiny molecule. I think it's like one dose is... 150 micrograms, which is like 1/100,000th of a gram. So
right.
Tiny. Such a fascinating, fascinating chemical that you can have that experience just based on brain chemistry, but we have these profound experiences. But I guess only recently have we kind of understood, recently as in like the last couple hundred years, what brain chemistry is, what chemistry actually is.
Right, and then the different sectors of the brain and how they work. And, you know, LSD and psilocybin, though they're completely different kingdoms mm-hmm. or different you know, chemical compounds,
yeah.
They work on the same part of the brain.
Right, they do.
Which is the executive part of the brain that I think, therefore I know, there are, therefore I am, sorry.
Yeah.
Cogito ergo sum.
Yes.
that, you know, all the pressure in the brain changes from functioning here to moving into the rest of the brain as far as I can see. I mean, I've seen those images of colorful...
Yep.
You call those things that, anyways, it's an image that highlights where the brain functioning is while you're not on psychedelics. And then when you are on psychedelics, the rest of the brain just lights up.
Oh, right.
Yeah. And so it somehow changes the, I want to say hydraulic pressure, but I don't know if that's actually what's happening.
I think like the electrofrequencies, something to do with the electricity. Yeah, I don't really understand it.
It just changes where it works, but it's so cool.
Yeah.
And it's so fascinating. And I think people all over the world of all different... backgrounds, socioeconomic backgrounds, all deserve to have access to this type of healing. Because at the end of the day, no matter who you are or what you've experienced, trauma, it is the same across the board for everybody. It's all relative how we suffer. And suffering is a part of the human condition. And suffering can reduce our ability to want to serve and help others because I'm so focused on my pain. But if I don't have pain, if I have resolved pain, if I've let it move through me and release a lot of that baggage, then I'm free to look outside myself and be in the service of others. And that is what community is all about at the end of the day. That's why, for instance, we love our town here is because of community. And I think that when we resolve these issues of pain and hurt inside of us, we can do better in our world and show up better. For our people.
I couldn't say it any better. Where were you born?
I was born in Okinawa, Japan.
Wow.
I was born on a U.S. military base.
Navy?
I was born on a Marine base.
Okay.
But my father was in the Navy, and my parents met at the Seaman's Club. My mother, I think, was always going to be an American. She studied English all throughout middle school and high school and was the premier translator of, you know, the high schools in her area. And she met my dad at the Seaman's Club, and my dad's super fun and charming and outgoing. And of course they got together, and my grandfather, who was the chief of police, hated every second of it.
On your mom's side or dad's side?
On my mother's side.
Okay.
And
so more traditional Japanese family.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And I don't know if my dad didn't know, or I mean, I'd like to think he knew because he was living in Japan, but he walks into my grandfather's home with his shoes on.
Oh.
Which is a huge no-no. And yeah. My dad's a little on the rebellious side, and I'll show you. So I don't know if that was the case, but it was really hard for my mom, I think, after that. My grandfather disowned my mom. And it was very hard. My mom became pregnant with me, but they ended up moving to the United States. And that's, ultimately where my mother's dreams. So I'm a daughter of an immigrant, even though I was born in Japan. I was born on U.S. soil. But I carry with me I'm not even first generation technically, but I have her first generation dreams and goals. She instilled them into me. All of the American dream for her was so raw and real and achievable. She could taste it. Mm. And at the end of the day, my parents, when I look back and I say, what the heck were you guys thinking getting together? They're so different. And thankfully, they're civil and cordial with each other these days. But, my mom worked two jobs, three jobs at times.
Mm.
Her English, as great as it was in Japan, was never good enough, and she speaks great now.
Yeah.
But it was hard for a time. So I grew up in Las Vegas.
Oh, cool.
Where my mom would end up.
Yeah.
And I K through college and then some. And it was an interesting place to grow up in the 90s. Highest teen pregnancy rate in the country.
Ooh.
People would go there to get married and then subsequently get divorced.
Mm.
And it was interesting. And my mother was always in my ear about things. Don't you get pregnant. If you get pregnant, I'm not helping you. And I believed her.
Yeah.
And I think that for me, I heard that a lot to the point where I was like, well, don't worry, Mom. I'll never get pregnant. And I'll never, probably never get married and I'll never have kids.
Mm-hmm.
And I really lived with that philosophy in my head. But it was because, I was the kid of a woman who worked so hard that, and I hardly got to see her or spend quality time with her, that I knew I wanted a different life. And I felt strongly that, if I did get pregnant, because, I had hardly any adult supervision around. My mom was working, and it was my brother and I, kind of left to our own devices in a town. You know what the town's nickname is.
Full of devices.
Uh-huh, full of vices. And, it's just, I don't want to call it a miracle, but because I was very intentional as a kid growing up in that town, that I wanted more out of life. And I didn't know what or how. I felt like the world was me standing on the edge of some cavernous canyon that I just knew I needed to be over there because I wanted to do big things. I have things to say, and Vegas just seemed small.
Mm.
Ironically, just not small-minded maybe, and I don't mean disrespect, but people think of Las Vegas as this one-trick pony of gaming and vices. And I knew that I didn't want to take any of that with me anywhere I went in the world. And so there was more. I needed to figure out more. And I ended up meandering along the way to find those things. I think I tuned my brain into seeking out the things and the people that I would need in order to learn and grow and show up in the world in a way that I could feel empowered and confident and thoughtful.
Right.
And so, yeah, a lot of meandering.
Yeah.
UNLV, I studied political science.
Interesting.
Yeah, I actually have a degree called, let me try to think of, it's an interdisciplinary degree. So I got to pick two things that I wanted to major in, but it's two things I got to major in, not just one thing. So I studied business management and political science, and then I had a capstone project at the end where I had to marry the two and talk about how political science and business management were in alignment with some project. And don't ask me what that project is right now, because I cannot think of it. But it really did start me in on thinking kind of outside of the box. I really liked that degree. I really liked these two areas, and I didn't want to pick just one. And it was really helpful, I think, for the rest of my life to be able to marry things that you wouldn't think would belong together. And then I think it's been a neat thing that's shown up in my life a lot, a pattern.
That's amazing. Because I could almost see you going into politics.
Oh, God.
I know it's like the worst thing you ever probably want to go into, but like you would probably be really good at it. As far as being like an actual bastion of hope and sincerity and actually doing what's right for the people.
Yeah.
But you've got better things going on.
It's not, you know, our culture is so hell-bent on making a politician the enemy. And
right.
Unfortunately, those politicians just step in it every single time. I know people that I've had conversations with before they ran for politics, and they speak some sort of way where, yeah, it's great, we're having a conversation. But then after they become a politician, they just sound like a politician, and it just sucks. Like, it's weird to have a standard and expectation of how a politician should be, and then for a person to become a politician and then just fall in line to that stereotype.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know.
Completely.
I don't want that. I would never. I just want to influence the way people think about the world. But I don't know anything about politics or policy or any of that. No way.
What kind of influence did your mother's Japanese influence have? And how old were you when you moved to the U.S.?
I was very young.
Yeah.
So I was only born in Japan. I was 10 months old.
Okay.
When I cried across the Pacific Ocean that foul day in, I guess it would have been 1982. Wild. Yeah, it was I guess I cried the entire way. My mom was devastated for herself. People were mean.
That's a long flight.
It is a long. It's like, 14, 13
yeah.
hours? Something
yeah.
like that. So, I was only born in Japan, but ever since I was old enough to speak, my mother would remind me I'm Okinawan. Okinawa has a completely different cultural history than Japan, and it had its own kingdom. The Ryukyu Island system was part of that kingdom, and they traded a lot with, I want to say, the Dutch, and they were likely, Okinawa was likely sanctioned by the Chinese government and the Chinese kingdoms.
Oh.
So as a trade partner and, you know, in order to get to Japan or China, you had to go kind of through the Ryukyu Islands. So they were the first ones to kind of intercept. And I'm guessing China wanted to make them an ally for that reason, of course. And they did so, and to probably the chagrin of Japanese society, who knows. But yeah, eventually Japan would take over Okinawa. I think it was in the 50s. I'm wondering if my mom was born after the fact or before. I want to say it was before. But there's a strong cultural connection to my Okinawan heritage that my mother always instilled in me. You are Okinawan and then you are Japanese.
Oh, wow. But
the irony is that when I was in Japan, I was not Japanese. I was American. And when I was in America, I was not American. I was Japanese. So I've always kind of lived in this weird place of as a half-breed, if you will. Hapa Haole is a term that I'm very familiar with, being half white. Grew up eating with chopsticks, white rice, miso soup, you know, all these things, Japanese words. Like I knew how to say gomen nasai, which is I'm sorry, or aishiteru, which is I love you. You know, these are the words that I grew up knowing. Well, when I was about 9 years old, my auntie and my mom had a conversation, and my auntie invited my brother and I to come live with them for a year. And it was foreign exchange like, but I was living with my own family. Family I'd never met. This is my mother's sister, her husband, his two parents, and their 1, 2, 4 kids in a 2-bedroom home.
Oh, wow. In Okinawa?
So in Okinawa, the oldest son takes on the parents, and they will live out their days with that family. And in Japan, it's very common for the rooms to be shared. So every night, we would open up the cabinets on the wall and pull out the futon bed and put it on the tatami mat and grab your pillow. And it would be me and my two cousins in one room and my oji-san, oba-san, aunt and uncle, and my brother and one more of my cousins on the floor there. And then another one downstairs in like a tiny little room. And the grandparents would sleep in the living quarters, the main living quarters of the home. So it was a bustling, interesting thing that I just came to know as normal. And so caring for the elderly and close family connections have always been feeling very natural to me. And dinner was always purchased that night. You'd go to the market every day and eat something that was super fresh. So the refrigerator was empty after school and full right before dinner.
Oh, wow.
So interesting. And then, I got to go to school. So I would have been in sixth grade in America, but I skipped sixth grade in America to go be in school in Japan, and it was fifth grade. And the schools in Japan have classroom windows, and it's very open air feeling, two floors. And when we would break for lunch, all of the kids would have lunch in the classroom. Several of the children would go to the cafeteria, pick up these big, heavy vats of soup, rice, and protein. And they would carry it to the classroom. We'd set up the desks all in a row, put the food on the desks, and then we would serve each other lunch. And so we'd all sit in the classroom and eat together. And when lunch was over, we'd stack up our bowls, put all the silverware in a big bin. The kids would take them back to the cafeteria to go get cleaned. Meanwhile, the kids that were still in the classroom would push all the desks to one side and sweep the floor, push all the desks to the other, finish sweeping the other side. Then we'd get on our hands and knees and speed wipe across, you know, the floor. Like literally I'm like running, but my hands are on the floor, and we'd wipe the floor back and forth, and put all the desks back. We're washing the windows. And of course, like all the students were broken up in this one classroom. So some were on classroom duty, some were on cafeteria duty, some were sweeping the front and cleaning out the cubby holes because all the kids had indoor shoes and outdoor shoes. And so they'd clean them all out and get all the dust and debris out from inside the cubbies. And then some would be downstairs with the hose watering the gardens. And I thought that was so weird when I was a kid, but I loved it. I loved it because I already knew what elementary school was. I had already been in elementary school. In fact, I was going into middle school, but now here I am in elementary school in Japan. And the sense of pride and camaraderie and just fun, doing mm-hmm. something responsible, you know, we're all being responsible, you know, and all the teachers are doing is orchestrating. Hey, you know, don't forget that. There's some leaves in there. Get those out. Or, you know, but otherwise hanging out while we did the work. So there were no janitors.
Oh, interesting.
We did the work, yeah. You know, and this was a thing that we did every day. This wasn't like once a week. It was, this is what you do every day for about an hour. And it broke up the day really nicely. And I brought it up to a teacher in America in Las Vegas. And she thought it was child abuse. Like, how could you ask the children to do that? And that was probably the first time that I had, I don't even know how to put it, just shock that there was such a divergence of philosophy in how to raise children or how to think about what children really can do. I mean, your daughter is actively working as your camera person. I mean, yeah, she knows how totally. To activate a camera and use a camera, mm-hmm. And a heavy-duty camera on a tripod.
Yeah, and she's four.
And she's four.
Yeah.
You know, and so
But they just, kids want to help. Like at that age, especially, like she wants to help cook and she loves to sweep. And so it's a great mindset for them to get in at that age.
Right.
Because they want to do it anyway.
They want to do it anyway. Children want to feel valued. They want to feel like their self-worth and their confidence is high. They want to feel like they're capable of doing things. And when they realize, you know, and Japan is very homogenous, which has its pros and cons. But the pros are that, you know, we can do this together. We can solve problems. We can take care of ourselves. And it's a very enmeshed and interconnected type of society that has a lot of benefits for just daily life and daily mental wellness, I think. They have their problems and their issues like every other society.
Mm-hmm.
So I don't want to sugarcoat anything, but I think it's just worth taking into consideration, especially as I think a lot of people are thinking about schools and how schools function, or even daycare and how we want to see our children raised, mm-hmm. you know, since both parents are working,
mm-hmm.
you know, what can we do to instill a sense of pride and community and ownership in these little humans? It's good for them.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And that's so interesting, the idea that the oldest kid takes care of the parents when they get older.
Yeah, I mean, that's another son.
The oldest son.
Yeah, that's the tradition.
So, I mean, that's something in America that's not really done. I think like a lot of times is they get old, they kind of have to fend for themselves. A lot of the elderly have to fend for themselves. They don't have people to take care of them, or they get put in nursing homes or assisted living facilities, which I think is the PC term now.
Yeah.
So it's a little sad, especially as like the next generation really starts to age. Like, what is that going to look like?
I literally think about it all the time. I am very fortunate. Michael and I are very fortunate that we can afford to take care of his mother and her sister. And we did so for his father as well. So Barbara and Paul have since passed on. And but to be able to know in my bones that they were getting the best care, the thing is everybody wants that for their parents. It's just that actually having to care for your own parents is extraordinarily taxing. Again, mm-hmm. especially when we're talking about trauma from the past, it's a very difficult task to ask a child to care for their parents. And yet the culture in Japan dictates that it can be done. And I worry that in America, it's just not the case, but there's got to be a way.
Mm-hmm.
There's got to be a way that we can care for our elderly in a compassionate, thoughtful, respectful, dignified way. And I wish more people would think about it and like start thinking about it right now, because yeah, we've got a legion of people that are going to need that help and care within the next 20 years.
And there, it does help with, I think, the sense of closure. Like for me, both my folks passed away at our family home, and we were able to be there. And, you know, with my father, he passed away afterwards. But I actually like moved back from, I was in Los Angeles. I was in the middle of my film and TV career. And when he got really sick, I was like, I'm putting this on hold, because it was just so special and helped all of us feel closure when my mom passed away. So I'm like, I got to do that with my father. And it's just, it really, I think, does help when that time does unfortunately come.
Yeah.
That when you can do that, it's kind of like, you know, coming from the circle of life, really. You know, they take care of you when you're a child and do all the things that are dirty and not fun. And you kind of have to do that for them, too. But that actually, once I did that, I was like, okay, I'm definitely ready to be a parent now.
Mm-hmm.
So it's really, it's a really amazing, almost psychedelic experience in a way.
Yeah.
Yeah.
A gift to be able to do that.
Yeah.
But the reality is so many people cannot afford to do that.
That's
true. They don't have the room, or, you know, but maybe those limitations are just mental limitations.
I think so.
Maybe we can get creative in the way that we care for our parents. I also think, you know, with childcare, you know, which is a major broken system as well, I just feel like it's ripe for vast change. And I just hope that whatever change happens with regard to childcare and senior care, and I think they go together somehow. I don't know how.
Oh, interesting.
I just feel like it's kind of the same.
Yeah. Is this, I wonder if this is a good segue to talk about the unhoused issue in our valley and the affordable housing issue, because I feel like this is kind of like on the same path of people intentionally or unintentionally taking care of the people who are most vulnerable, which we have obviously, you know, this is the hot topic in the Flathead Valley in Montana, is just the shock and unpreparedness. I mean, Whitefish has kind of been dealing with the affordable housing issue, trying to figure it out for years, and we've gone to battle with the state about it. But I mean, COVID, holy smokes. I mean, to actually see like friends have to move to Kalispell or Sea Falls or move just out of the state because they're in a house and they're renting it and the owners decided to sell it to someone who's going to offer them $1 million cash. I mean, that's like a very tempting thing. And then to that end, like, you know, there were elderly people who then became homeless because they were living on Social Security or a small pension. And that's like really shocking and sad. And it's, you know, unfortunately, you see certain cities have banned panhandling, you know, just further putting the limits on what people can do to take care of themselves.
Right. Or, you know, you can't sleep here
right.
or there mm-hmm. or really anywhere. And, you know, I subscribe to the philosophy that you will be judged by the way you treat your most vulnerable. Mm. And I still feel very strongly about that. And being in a position of so much privilege and so much resource, I can't forget the things that happened to me when I was a kid. My mom, I mean, I know what it's like to be homeless. Mm. And I know what it's like to have a parent who's working and can't afford a place to live. So, yeah, these are very important issues that I think are solvable. I think we need to get the right people in the room together to have conversations. And I think it needs to happen soon, like pronto. We live in a valley of about 120,000, 130,000 people maybe now. Mm-hmm. After this is post-COVID, I believe. Even though I think our most recent numbers are from 2019 census. There are a lot of new people in the valley. And there's this presumption that it's the new people that are causing, that are becoming homeless or something to that effect, that these homeless people need to go back to where they came from. They came from Olney, okay? They came from your neighborhood, okay? They were born here.
Right.
And they have had it always. Maybe some of these people were living paycheck to paycheck all of their lives, but certain economic forces took place as a result, largely to the pandemic, where their wages did not match the cost of living. And when people came in and offered these sweetheart, or not sweetheart, but these, you know, unbelievable cash deals,
yeah.
You know, sell me your ranch or sell me your house or whatever, kick your tenants out. I want this and I'll remodel it and make it something bougie and then resell it and make a profit. These people live and have always lived here, and they're homeless now.
Mm-hmm.
And the board of the Warming Center received so much flack. They were in the newspaper. I don't understand the position of the commissioners in how they presented their point of view with regard to these very real neighbors of ours. It felt contemptuous and it felt divisive. And really what we need is more compassion and kindness and thoughtfulness about the humans and how they got there. It is my understanding that there is a segment of the homeless that will always be homeless. It's about 15%. They are chronically homeless due to mental factors, hardcore trauma, that has prevented them from being able to function properly in the world. And I think those people are a humongous tax on our resources. They use up the most amount of police interactions. They are, you know, on drugs or alcohol or both, and They just require so much of our taxpayer dollars. That is a fact. I'm a proponent for low barrier housing for those people, or even no barrier housing, because look, we're paying money already. When every time a cop goes out, we're paying taxpayer money already. How about we take that, if we're just going to say this is a fact, how do we take that money that we would spend on those resources whenever they have a call out for those people to instead use that money, build no barrier housing, and have a place for that person to live where they can do all the things that they do inside mm-hmm. their home.
Yeah.
Like all the things I do inside my home is my business.
Right.
They can do whatever they want inside their home. That's their business. But now they have a safe and protected place to live where people cannot violate them in the same way that they've violated when they're vulnerable and on the street. And then the next thing is to take a look at the sector of people that are unhoused, but they want to be housed. And I tell you what, if you go down to the warming center right now and interview any of those people, just ask them how many jobs they have. How many? Okay, because it's often two.
Really?
Right.
Yeah.
Okay, at least one.
Yeah.
But often two. And they just can't make enough money for the down payment, because you need first and last month's rent and a cleaning deposit. And you have to choose between that and like getting your transmission fixed, you know, because you need your car, because otherwise there is no going to work, mm-hmm. you know, unless you can live right where you work or, you know, park your car at your job. But no, you have to drive to your job and you need, you know, so it's,
this is Montana.
Yes, this is exactly. It's Montana. And we drive to work. So if we take into consideration who these people are and their unique needs, and I don't know if the solution is a policy issue. Maybe it's a combination of policy and private funding.
Mm-hmm.
Obviously, we can't be the only ones ever to help with these types of solutions. I would love to have conversations with people who want to do something about it. I want to know about housing materials that are low cost, very durable, and that can be assembled very quickly. Not traditional nail into wood housing.
I'd like to see prefab.
Like I'd like to see a 3D printer roll up and print me a house. Yeah. I mean, why can't we do that?
Yeah.
And I think we can. I think these companies are new. They need funding. They need to be tried and true, but they're out there. And I think if we just think outside of the box and marry possibilities that we don't think would normally go together, then we all of a sudden have so much solution at our fingertips. We just have to pick which one we want to implement. I just, you know, I want to get outside of the I can't and into how. How can we resolve these issues for these people? And I'm not going to talk about how much what I'm doing exactly right now, because I want to let the pressure cooker sit
sure.
for a minute. But I really want to help influence people to do right by their neighbors.
That's amazing. And especially with so many large businesses, I think, you know, the conversation is some businesses are providing housing for their employees. So like mm-hmm. with employee housing, I think, you know, it's actually commendable, like shout out to the Averills, because they've
yep.
took the down, well, I'm not sure if this is public knowledge, but they have a place where they have great housing for their employees, and it's a place that they could have turned into a nice big hotel, but they're just using it for employee housing, probably because they have to. But I mean, that seems to be a conversation where, I mean, it's, you know, the ski resort, they've got their own housing in town. And so there does seem to be, I think, a business strategy that it does make sense to provide housing for your employees.
Yes.
I'm not sure what like that looks like as far as if that comes out of their paychecks and whatnot. But I mean, that's, you know, I guess that's, in a way, that's free market capitalism in a way.
Yeah.
Kind of figuring it out.
I love when business owners, corporations, people with a lot of money do the right thing, even mm-hmm. when they don't have to. I think a lot of businesses are in a pinch and they really do have to buy housing. I think Jalisco is another one that owns a lot of houses and so for their employees. And we do as well. Two Bear does. And yes, it's definitely a carrot for those employees to be able to have a home to live in. And in our situation, it's not necessarily tied to employment. But I would love to, I mean, I don't know how it can be. And I'm okay with that. I'm okay with not knowing how. But I do know what it is that I see as a real boon for all of the towns in this valley, which is we could have the opportunity to have a bustling downtown that is live, work, shop. And if there were a place in town where people could live in apartments, and, you know, I've been asked, you know, who the hell wants to live downtown? I would love to live downtown. Yeah. When I was in downtown Las Vegas, I lived downtown. I lived in a high rise. I'll never live in a high rise ever again after knowing what it's like to live in Montana. But, you know, it's important and it's vibrant and it can be so fun, especially when you're young and you're not attached to anybody and you can work and play and don't have to drink and drive.
Exactly.
You know, like there's so many benefits. I would love to remove all the parking on Central Avenue. Just remove it and put more trees and have your chairs and water features for the kids. And just during the summer months, let people walk up and down Central Avenue and put the car somewhere else. I'd love to see a parking garage behind 101 Central.
Sure.
I'm actually like, how much would a parking garage cost? I wonder.
Yeah.
You know, and just getting creative with the way that we see our communities. Giant cities like Paris. I know we're not Paris. I know we're not France. I know. And at the same time, it's important to be able to see when people are doing it right. And they've built housing for their middle class. And it's subsidized. And I know that's a bad word, but we subsidize our farms. We subsidize food. Why not subsidize Walmart? We subsidize
yeah.
all kinds of things.
Everything gets subsidized.
I just feel like if we invest in our people, the very people with education, housing, the ability to access food and nutrition, that's just so basic, foundational. And I love a free market society. I love things about capitalism, not all things.
Me too.
I love that it spurs innovation. You know, I don't want to lose any of that. But I'm saying that what we're doing isn't working. So how can we focus on a solution to what can work? And I think if you do right by people and create spaces for humans, not cars, there are plenty of, this is Montana, there are plenty of places for our cars to drive fast. Great. And do that. But I want to see density in our towns. I like the idea of infill, more parks, walkability, tentacles extending from say Whitefish to Sea Falls, where I can ride my bike all the way down and back and just, you know, feel connected. I'd also love to see mass transportation in the valley.
Mm-hmm.
I'd love to see electric buses.
Mm-hmm.
If they could survive the winters.
Yeah.
So maybe we'll have a combustion engine for those.
Yeah. Or hybrids.
Yeah. Yes. Yeah. You know, and make them beautiful. And then if people have to live in Kalispell because it's less expensive and work in Whitefish, they can still work in Whitefish, shop in Whitefish, let's be honest, drink in Whitefish, and then get on a bus and get home safely, you know,
yeah.
and reduce traffic. I mean, everybody talks about, oh, the traffic, but we're from towns where...
Oh my gosh. I'm like, are you kidding me? It's like, yeah, sure. The 3:30 school traffic is a little annoying, but
it's very annoying.
Oh my goodness. I mean, that's no like Wilshire Boulevard in LA in the middle of rush hour or the 405 or Vegas.
And then plus you have wildlife
in
the mix as well. And, you know, people are driving and they hit a deer and it's like, you know, somebody told me they had $8,000 worth of damage to their truck.
Oh.
I was like, ow. You know, reduce the amount of traffic.
Yeah.
Because, I mean, I think there's a fair amount of people that, you know, if they got to go to work, you know, they'll just take the bus. Or if you want to go dine at Urban Omni and you want to have, you know, a wine pairing with dinner and you just take a beautiful public transportation back to Big Fork or something.
That'd be
so rad.
That'd be amazing.
Yeah.
Kind of getting back to this idea of taking care of the most vulnerable and how that applies to your philanthropic philosophies I'm kind of interested to explore, especially you guys have a new venture called Two Bear Cares.
Yeah.
Can you tell me about that one? Because that one's really interesting and I think is on brand with what we're talking about.
Yep. It's very brand new, 501c3, and Cheyenne and Mike Peters started brainstorming. I think it's been going on for a couple years now, but the pain point that they noticed with their little kids in school was that, you know, even though their kids had all their needs met, there were so many of their kids' friends that don't have basic needs met. I'm talking about a little boy who cannot see without his glasses, but he sat on them or broke them because he's 7. You know, that's what happens, but that's the only pair that he had. And for whatever reason, the parents are unable to afford, get transportation to, make the time to get new glasses. And meanwhile, this kid is like,
oh no,
trying to read. And these teachers, you know, take out their wallet,
yeah,
and pay for the stuff. So on average, $1,500 a year. I think that's a low estimate.
That teachers pay out of their pocket just to take care of their students.
Whether it's to host a birthday party because, you know, this 10-year-old has never had a birthday party. I mean, it's heartbreaking. Or, you know, to see something that lights up a student that is otherwise without normal means. And when I say normal, without means to get a glove for baseball. And this kid loves baseball or loves football or loves some sport. And to be able to be given a football that costs $16, right? And how it changes everything for that kid because I'm in the NFL. You know, I can see myself. I've got my ball and I, you know, it gives hope. And I think it brings joy to those teachers to be able to do that. So Two Bear Cares is a foundation right now. Sorry, it's not a foundation. It's set up where right now Michael is the only one who is donating to this. And we're not sure exactly how we want to see it in the future. There are a lot of issues around, you know, we don't want to shame parents for not being able to afford these things. There's a pride issue as well, mm-hmm. With other people giving you handouts that you didn't ask for. And so I want to be very sensitive to that. And I think what we're doing is we've rolled out something that's kind of quiet right now in the way that we just want to make sure that we kind of work through any issues or bugs in the way that it's rolled out. But a teacher can go online, fill out a form, answer 3 basic questions. They're very simple questions like, you know, what's this for? You know, what do you think is the benefit? And I can't remember the 3rd question, but it's just literally 3 questions. And not I, but, you know, Cheyenne and her team go through it. And her team is other teachers and faculty members that know these students and know their parents. And they assess, you know, that this is a qualified need. And there is a fund that they can pull from so they don't have to pull money out of their own wallets to pay for these very important things for these students. And it takes the burden off of the teachers because obviously they're getting paid, what, $32,000 a year, which how can they even? And they show up every day. And this is, and what it does too is for a teacher to be able to do that for a student, even if it's out of their own pocket, it brings them joy. But now it doesn't have to come out of their own pocket, and it still brings them joy.
Oh.
In fact, it's like more joyful because it doesn't have to come out of their pockets, you know?
Yeah.
So it's a pilot program we're working on, but it's a bona fide 501c3. And yeah, we'll be making a little PSA about it.
Awesome.
Really just to get feedback and learn how we can implement it even better.
Is this just for the Flathead Valley? Is it statewide?
Right now it is just a handful of schools,
okay,
that we're working with. And I think Michael has just injected it with about $50,000. So
that's
we're
huge.
Just going to see like how is the money spent, find the trends, average out, you know, what the giving is, how much it costs every time we do some of these projects. And then, you know, how long this money will last So we're just in the inception,
mm-hmm.
And it's exciting and it feels really good.
That's so great.
Yeah.
And this is really kind of adding to, I think, the need in the education system. That is, I think we're kind of, I was talking to Marianne Smith on my last episode,
yes,
about how
I
kind of outdated the education system is. I think with how fast technology is growing and becoming part of our lives, the education system is just having a hard time keeping up. And I think that's why you see a trend of families homeschooling more, looking for alternative forms of education.
Absolutely.
I mean, that's what my partner and I are totally considering right now. It's like, are we going to homeschool? But then you guys support Code Girls United, which I think is just such the coolest organization, because it's giving kids an opportunity to learn how to code and how to develop business plans and marketing. And again, the next generation at a certain point is a very vulnerable generation. Working here at Deliver Fund, you know, we see what social media does to kids who are especially socioeconomically disadvantaged, come from broken homes, how they have become prey just in the last 15 years. It's pretty scary, but also exciting to know that there are people like you and Michael and Nick here at Deliver Fund doing things that are impactful. So I guess, is there a philosophy behind your philanthropy?
Yes, there is. And suffice it to say, there's lots of really worthy nonprofits in the country to be donating to. And some I find very, very important to the fabric of our democracy. But in order to make the biggest dent and to feel the biggest dent, giving within the confines of the state of Montana is important to us. And even before we give to the state of Montana, or like to nonprofits within the state of Montana, more of a focus on the valley is really where our focus is, because it's a measurable impact that will tell us and give us appropriate feedback. But also, you know, we're going to die here. This is it for us. We want to see everything working in a way that our kids will benefit, but also when they leave, because they will, that when they come back, when they're 28 and they go, oh, this is what oh my gosh, it's such a contrast from the city. This is why I want to come back, and this is why it's still good for our kids to want to come back, because we need to have great education. We need to be taking care of our most vulnerable people. And I think that really enhances the beauty, the overall beauty and aesthetic of our towns when people are cared for. And then they do well to care for the infrastructure and the community as well. But then also being able to build relationships with those 501c3 founders and feeling the impact locally is just, it just feels like, it feels right. It feels like home. So our strategy and our philosophy is to keep it home in Montana.
That's amazing.
Yeah, in the valley.
I mean, you really can't go out without feeling the positive impact from like the Whitefish Trail systems. Mm-hmm. I mean, I'm definitely a little bit more risky in the backcountry because I know I can just call Tuba Air to come get me out.
Oh, yeah. You think they're just going to come help?
I mean, yeah, I hope they would.
It's true. No, but they certainly would. Of course. And yeah, and Tuba Air actually does service, what, 6 states?
Yeah.
Locally. So,
yeah. It's a, what, 350-mile range, I think?
That sounds about right. I feel like you would know more about that technicality than me. But yeah, and we want to live here. We want to work here. This is it for a lot of us. And so how are we going to participate in designing and building? So we're at this really cool opportunity. A lot of cities that are big, you know, they started off a century ago, right? Mm-hmm. Before they got really big, or more than a century ago. And here we have this little valley with a relatively small population, and we can implement change. This is our petri dish, and we can affect change. We can try things, and I don't want to say experiments because that sounds weird and sciencey, but we can try things and see if they work. And theoretically, those things can be applied to those other cities. But as we grow, we have the opportunity to look at, see how they could have done things better and didn't, and the consequences, and then adjust ourselves and alter our trajectory so that we can look back and go, gosh, glad we did that. I'm sure the city of Whitefish wishes that they would have bought up more land to build public, or, you know, build housing on and to do a lot of different things. But now, obviously, we're, you know, at the whim mm-hmm. of whatever the market dictates for a piece of land. And so that really does severely limit what we can do in that sector. That's why I call on the private sector to, you know, let's get together and create a fund that is sustainable. I mean, we all want to see our money go towards something that is going to really bear fruit. And there's a way to do it. There's a lot of smart people that live up here.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't have all the answers, but I want to get into a room together and discuss how we can grow responsibly. And for all those people that really just detest the idea of more people moving here, I call those people the ones that, you know, they want to get in and shut the gate behind them.
Mm-hmm.
But there is no gate. There just isn't a gate.
Mm-hmm.
So now that you know that there is no gate, this is where we are, and people will move here. How are we going to do this in a responsible, thoughtful way for the sake of our kids, so that when they want to come back and live here and be stewards of the land, that they will have the infrastructure around them and the lifestyle that makes them want to stay and raise their kids here, because that's what we want.
Mm-hmm.
It's beautiful. This is God's country.
Mm-hmm.
Why let it get messed up? It's so beautiful. We just have to keep it that way. It's a challenge.
It certainly is.
I'm up for the challenge. I want to work with people.
Yeah.
With builders,
mm-hmm.
investors. There's just so many ideas.
There's a wealth of knowledge between, like, Casey Malmquist is a great example. Like, he's such a great guy, and
yes.
like built his company from the ground up and really has seen how that has worked. And my buddy Ty Frank, who we went to high school together, is now, I think, taking it over. And so I'm actually kind of excited to see what the future's like, because I think there are right people in the private sector that are handling like construction and development.
Mm-hmm.
I guess we can shift to how the family's recovered from what you guys went through a few years ago. I
mean, which one are we talking about?
About the man. Right?
Just kidding.
The man who shall not be named. When something as traumatic as what you guys went through, as far as just being taken advantage of by really terrible people and coming out of that, I mean, I guess there's no like playbook with how you respond and heal from someone trying to destroy your family, essentially. What have you learned from that? What are your thoughts on that experience coming out of it?
Well, it's all very shocking. And yet so many people right now are going through some level of what we went through, which it's so very easy to be taken advantage of, bullied online. Those things can affect a person's mental well-being. You know, there's nothing worse than feeling alienated from the whole wide world because of the things that are said online. But that guy worked with several other people that were involved in a whole host of lawsuits and campaigns against my husband. And I know a lot of people have sentiments about the rich and, you know, eat the rich and all that other stuff. I hear that. And there is a way to make money where you don't have to screw people over. In fact, there's a way to make money where you benefit all those you work with and the world as a whole as a result of being in business. And that is the position, and that's the box that my husband is in. And there's many people like him. So when this guy came after us and worked very diligently with very powerful people with resources, I mean, this is the kind of thing that kills people. And if it doesn't kill you because you didn't kill yourself, it'll just kill your spirit. That's what character assassination is. It kills you. And I don't know.
Yeah.
Maybe it's Boston. Yeah. Michael growing up in Bedford.
Right.
fighting a lot. I mean, he's a tough guy. And a good friend of ours wrote us a note that said something like, you know, no one can say you can't take a hit. And that's always been true, literally and figuratively speaking. So Michael's a fighter, and he's literally the biggest geek I've ever heard of.
Yeah.
The man reads textbooks for fun and absorbs them in a way, like, he knows all the different parts and names and things like I'm not good at that.
It keeps his attention. Like, he's
he's extraordinary. And people would ask, you know, how does someone so smart get swindled like that, like that bad? Because it was bad. And the fact is, you know, when you're on 16 boards and you're out there trying to, like, do cool, important stuff, people come in, tell you all you want to hear, and cut you at your knees. And that's really what happened. But we both, in private, Michael and I, and with our family, made a decision years and years ago that no matter how this shakes out, we will never stop remembering who we are and what we stand for. And that this was a bunch of bullshit, that as a result of our lax media policies or whatever, just it was able to flourish. Mm-hmm. And, you know, it's not fair when 200 million clicks in 24 hours can take you out. It's just the way that the world works and the way the world operates. So when all of that was going on, it was really important for Michael to be able to take the time to prove his innocence. And he did. Line by line,
mm-hmm.
page after page, reading everything, looking at everything. I mean, people can say, oh, he's got all the lawyers in the world. And yeah, he does. He has really great lawyers. And no disrespect to that legal team, who, by the way, I know them. I care about them. They really did help us. But the lion's share of the work was Michael proving his innocence and really just open kimono. What? Like, this is who I am. I had affairs. I suck. Yes. Okay. That was literally the worst thing I've ever done in my life. And for that, you know, he's got wives and ex-wives mm-hmm. that will always hold him to that fact that he, you know, had affairs. He will never get to live that down. But he has our grace and forgiveness. At least I'm speaking for myself.
Mm-hmm.
And so it felt really good to be able to work diligently to be able to prove his innocence. And he did over and over and over again in a court of law. And so from there, it's like, okay, moving on.
Right.
Because the real crime was 5 years of Michael's life was spent doing that when it could have been working on important issues like glioblastoma, pancreatic cancer, even AI and the technologies and the capabilities of AI, or just understanding why cancer does what it does and making it stop. But that's what he's working on now. And that's, I mean, it lights him up when we get to hang out at night and he tells me about the things that he's working on. I mean, I want to get him on this podcast so bad.
Yeah.
Because I want him to just give you an idea of some of the things that he talks about. And you're going to light up. I mean, it's going to freak you out because it's so cool.
Uh-huh.
And I get to hear these things. And it's so energizing and so cool. And it really does help. When we think about all the things that happened to us, the silver lining is that there were things that we got to learn and grow from, and now we're ready to move on with the thickest skin ever.
Yeah.
Okay? Like, I mean, yeah, if I were to run for politics, which I'm not ever going to run for politics, at least that would be something worth having as a thick skin, or a business owner even, you know?
Well, I mean, the thing is, too, the majority of people will never have their dirty laundry aired out for the whole world to look upon. And I mean, that's the problem with people just love to look at other people's dirty laundry, whether if it's true or not.
Yeah.
And as you know, Nick, we were talking about it, as Nick eloquently put, you know, may the sinless man cast the first stone. And I was like, man, that is so true.
Mm-hmm.
It's like if everyone in the whole town or the whole community just like had a day of like, okay, we're all going to share our dirty laundry now, people would probably shut the fuck up real quick.
Yeah. Pardon of course French. They would. And no, no, you don't have to pardon to
yeah.
me. It's a matter of time before that guy gets out of federal prison.
Oof.
I know he spends his mornings eating powdered eggs off of tin plates.
Ugh.
I think that that's what he deserves. Continue, please. But no, one day he will be let out, and it's no doubt in my mind his campaign will continue.
Mm.
And that's a reality of our life. But now we have different methodologies for how to handle that. And whatever. I people will talk. And I can say that if you have something bad to say about me, you just don't know me. Or you heard it from that guy. But
mm-hmm.
no.
Yeah.
Like, there's life is too important. And whatever campaign that they try to throw at us in the future, if anything, I mean, maybe not. Maybe they'll move on and get a life.
Right.
Then, you know, whatever. We've got this. But yeah, living open kimono is definitely something that we, that was new to us. But honestly, now that we're here, it's okay. Like,
yeah.
We're open books. We have nothing to hide. And at the end of the day, just really want to work on important things for all of us.
Well, I was... love to talk about your newest venture, which is like my favorite thing in the world, and that is Herb and Omni.
Yes.
It's such an amazing thing what you have done with that amazing building. So what was the idea behind turning that 101 Central into Herb and Omni?
During the pandemic, it was clear, more clear than ever at that time, that how Casey's had been operating, it was just a quaint operation. It was, you know, come in, get your drinks, and we have this tiny little hot kitchen line upstairs. Yeah, we can flip burgers and make elk chili. And downstairs was this prep kitchen, and it was disconnected. You know, we have two different kitchens on two different floors. And it was, you know, put it this way. It's a lot of labor to cover three floors, and labor is generally one of the largest expenses in overhead for any business that operates, that has employees. And it just wasn't cutting it. This is our cute little nonprofit organization, so to speak. And here's this just beautiful building on this beautiful corner in this beautiful town that was just wah-wah. You know, and it was fun on a Friday night or a Saturday night, you know.
Yeah.
But there's also downsides to operating a business that is open until that late. And
the riffraff
just
come
kinda rocking over it. Yeah, you know, I always said I'd open a juice bar, but I didn't think I'd actually open a bar or run a bar.
Yeah.
It was always like ironic to me.
Yeah.
So during the pandemic, I was able to talk Michael into considering what it could look like. Kitchen all on one floor on the basement level, main dining room filled with guests, really great food, and entertainment on the other two floors. And that's essentially what it has become. And we have local purveyors. I think 95% of our meat is coming from the valley.
Wow.
A good percentage of our produce, especially in season, will be coming from the valley. And, you know, it doesn't look like Montana when you walk into Urban Omni. I think everybody's, not everybody, but people have commented, you know, it's so bougie and, you know, it's too fancy for me and all this other stuff. And, you know, I feel really bad about that. I certainly didn't design it with that in mind. I never wanted to exclude or make people feel uncomfortable when they were in the restaurant, because especially I think like breaking bread together is such an important, it's so much more nourishing than just the food you're eating, to be able to eat with friends and run into people unexpectedly. But it's this place that has these fine looking features, mirrors, brass, green tiles. But if you look closely, you'll see my honeybee affinity.
Oh.
In the shapes of some of the pendants. They look like beehives. Over the bar, we have these shapes that look like the beehives from the monk days when they were making mead out of honey.
Oh, right.
Can
yeah,
you
yeah.
picture what they, yep. those mm-hmm. basket weave hives? And then in one of the booths, I painted gold leaf onto the back wall. So it looks like gold is emerging from the back wall. But the chandelier has these glass, it looks like dripping glass. Like it's just dripping. And so with the gold reflected behind it, I like the idea that it's golden honey just dripping
from
the branches, you know? And I wanted to highlight the honeybee. I have always loved the honeybee. She is a fastidious worker that pollinates a third of our food production, and she does it tirelessly. And, you know, people want to call me a queen bee. I'm not a queen bee. The queen bee is laying an egg every single minute of her waking life for 4 years.
Oh.
Okay, that's a queen bee. Boy, she literally works her butt off. But so really it's a place to feel comfortable is what I wanted it to be, and to find Montana in the cuisine. So you walk in and maybe you see antler chandeliers and you see my good friend Mallory and her artwork of a doe peering out of the forest. A masculine and feminine representation with the doe and the antlers.
Oh.
But it's when you sit down and you meet your server and they're here to serve and help, and you eat local food grown up by local people, and these are local businesses we're supporting. And yes, it's more expensive to produce that food. Unfortunately, food, just because it's locally grown, doesn't necessarily mean it's less expensive.
Mm-hmm.
These farms aren't necessarily being subsidized, you know, by government or anything like that. And some of them are USDA organic. And
oh yeah, that's
it's just
not easy. It's not easy to grow. Like once one cattle gets an antibiotic, then it can't be considered organic anymore.
I know.
Wild.
So, this is the kind of, it's a experiment on showing people what Montana is.
Mm-hmm.
When they're not out on the range or out in the mountains or on the rivers, come here and eat this food. It is brilliant. And Chef Earl, being born and raised here in Montana in Whitefish, to be able to be in this restaurant, I mean, it feels like home for us, and he's got a humongous following that for him to be able to work with these local purveyors, I mean, it's just this net cast across the valley that really encompasses the essence of why this place is so beautiful. And it's right there in the food.
Right
there
really
in the way
is.
It's made. Mm-hmm.
And I'm so actually happy that it's not that Montana chic. When I first went in there, I was like, oh, thank goodness. I was so relieved. And I mean, because it's
dark wood. And
yeah, I mean, yeah. There's a time and a place for that.
Sure.
Like the Remington. I love like what the Remington, like that vibe is great. It works.
Yeah.
But I don't know if it's maybe just because I've like lived in major cities that I kind of miss that vibe of going somewhere. Not that's fancy, I guess it's fancy, but there's just artistry and thoughtfulness and mindfulness in the decor and everything you did to just like having all those mirrors just makes it feel like a bigger room.
Right.
And you can see other people and you can kind of like look around and kind of like spy on everyone and stuff,
yeah,
which is,
I mean,
so fun.
Yeah, that's exactly the utility of having those mirrors, is to create space and to reflect light, you
mm-hmm.
know. But yeah, the side effects,
yeah,
as you mentioned, are just as divine. So.
And the servers are fantastic. It's like we had like, when my partner and I went, I feel like we had like 3 or 4 people coming to check on us. We had like, is it Vincenzo coming to like, how are the drinks? And, you know, Earl comes out and checks on everyone's food. And we had like 2 or 3 people that were helping us and stuff. So really, really, but that's kind of the community vibe in a way.
Right. And, you know, I feel strongly that leadership from the top trickles down to the way people feel about where they work. And it's really important for me. I'm not perfect at it. And I have a lot to learn. I never in my wildest dreams thought I'd actually own a restaurant that was born out of my brain. It blows my mind even still. But as it relates to all of our employees, whether they're Two Bear employees or whether they are our partners over at Two Bear Farm or, you know, at 101 Central, it's so important that people feel a sense of pride and ownership in where they work. And so they tell me oftentimes what needs to change and what needs to go on. And it's my job to listen and implement accordingly. Mm-hmm. Not everything, obviously, but the things that I think are working or that are valuable, that the guest experience can be enhanced. And I've been able to work with, I've had tremendous resources about, you know, the conception and building of, and then now implementation of the services of this restaurant. And it is of my humble gratitude that I could work with such incredible people that know so much more about restauranting than I do. But as a person who was raised in Las Vegas, one thing I do know is hospitality. Mm. I care a lot about hospitality, which is the difference between service, which is I'm getting my needs met with service. Hospitality is I'm getting my feels met. You know, I feel like this place cares about me. I feel like I'm not just a number. I feel like they remembered my name. I feel like they remembered my kid or whatever, you know, just it's all about people.
Yeah.
And it's people focused and people centered. Oh. And then food.
Yep. So then second story is entertainment.
Yes.
And you have the Second Story Band and Cabaret. Are they coming back this summer?
I cannot wait. So I met with Becky the other day, and
oh, nice.
She was just gushing with emotion and buzzing with excitement because, yeah, they've got a great show coming on.
Amazing.
They will be with us all summer.
Awesome.
Take a break again in October, and then we'll do another one for the holidays.
Nice.
And it feels like a really good rinse and repeat. Mm-hmm. So hopefully this will be a long-lasting relationship, really with a handshake. I love those people.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Such talent with Meredith and Halliday and, with the band.
And the Second Story Band, same thing. This is talent that lives here. They work here. Their kids go to school here. They're teachers, you know, and for them to have this ability to perform what they love and who they are in this communal setting, like, it feels so rich. I'm learning what the market can afford or can't afford as far as ticket sales and things like that. So March and April, we're doing like Fridays with the Second Story Band, and it's complimentary. Just get your butt up there.
Okay.
Yeah, get your butt up there and listen to some live music. All songs you know, you know, and there's a bar, and it just feels comfortable, and the upper level is nice and cozy, and it's just turning out to be this really fantastic vibe,
yeah,
and hub for live music.
Oh, that's so amazing. So,
and theater as well.
Yeah.
And speaker series, Brian Schott and the Whitefish Review, you know, they always pack the house, and these are, you know, the kinds of things that are good for the community. And so for us to be able to be involved in my ability to make money on those things is not the driving factor. It's really to bring people into the same room together. And obviously I get the benefit of, maybe I'll try Urban Omni tonight,
mm-hmm.
you know, versus not even being in the room and having that thought. But also just, you know, I just love being around people, and people that have things to say that are important or music to share that feels so good.
Oh, so, it's so amazing that there is a space for like the Whitefish Review, which is this amazing literary publication that, like you said, it really draws. And
an
I mean, we had like
crowd.
Jeff Bridges and Susan Bridges
I
there
know.
Like
I got
a
my
couple
picture.
Months ago.
I got my picture with them both. It felt surreal.
Yeah.
Where am I? Yeah.
You're in your own place. That's great.
It felt, I'm like, I'm in my own house. This is cool.
That's so amazing.
Yeah.
How would you describe Whitefish or the Whitefish community to someone, say you just like ran into some tourists or some people that were new on the street? Like, how would you explain Whitefish?
Pristine. And
that's a great word.
Yeah. Cause it is, as long as we don't, you know, mess it up,
mm-hmm.
it'll stay that way. So I would advise people to consider visiting outside of the summer. I would advise them to consider exploring the mountains and the rivers this time of year, or even in the fall,
Oh, fall is so beautiful.
I know, but maybe I shouldn't say that because I know a lot of people love their Octobers and Septembers here. But I am a big proponent of small business. So I want to guide people to come here in the shoulder season because not only does it benefit this person who's seeing another side, another facet of Montana, but also because when they come and they stay, it benefits hotels, restaurants, and other small businesses on Central Avenue and beyond. And I know it's been really hard for a lot of small businesses to stay afloat, to hire people, and visiting in the off season, it's so beautiful and peaceful and tranquil. And I just recommend taking into consideration the shoulder season for visit.
Yeah.
Yeah.
All the locals are out.
Yeah.
The vibe is just good.
Yeah, if you want to meet people in the valley, they scram in the summertime. They're not around. You're just going to meet other tourists.
Yeah.
But if you want an opportunity to meet some of the locals, yeah, they're out right now.
Have you found there is, now that you're like, there's some amazing restaurants in Whitefish and word travels fast. Do you find that there is a sense of camaraderie or competition amongst like the restaurant scene?
I can't really speak to how other restaurateurs are feeling or what their sentiments are necessarily. I for one, I think competition is just in your head. I'm not in competition with anyone. I mean, if other people are in competition with our business, okay. But we're not.
Yeah.
I know that a lot of restaurateurs have come in. Not a lot, sorry. A few restaurateurs have come in and made comment and given kudo to what we've built, and that feels really amazing. There's room for all of us. If we can consider again a bustling downtown and what that could feel like for locals, then all of our restaurants will do better. Why take out when you can just go down the street and eat and then go home right after, you know? But no, I don't feel like we're a competition. If anything, we all share the same pool of labor, and when one restaurant does well, it's an opportunity for the other restaurants to do well, so rising tides can raise ships. I encourage other restaurants to please take into consideration that extra 1%. We have a 3% sales tax in Whitefish, a resort tax, sorry, not sales tax, and that extra 4%, that 1%, half of that goes to Explore Whitefish, which is an organization I believe strongly in. They were misunderstood as a organization that is here to just increase tourism, period. And after doing a deep dive with Julie Mullins, I've come to realize all they want to do is manage the tourism.
Mm-hmm.
So we get the bulk of our tourism in the summertime, and it's just like full on and inundated. But then the rest of the season, it's like crickets.
Right.
And yes, the locals, I get that the locals like that, but the local business owners are suffering. Their bottom lines are suffering. Their ability to do expansions or even just fix and repair things that need to be fixed or have been neglected for too long, you know, they can't afford to do those things. And they need to have a healthy bottom line. And we can give that to them by encouraging fewer people to maybe visit in the summertime, which I don't see that as a bad thing. We're busy enough.
Mm-hmm.
And then spread it out. Just spread it out like peanut butter on the toast.
Yeah.
You know, just spread it out. And so that 1%, which is a restaurant and a hotel additional tax. So if you come into my restaurant, it is an additional 1%. It is optional, but is already on your bill. Yes, you can have it taken off. And we will be happy to do that. And I just want to make that so very clear.
Yeah.
But the other half of that 1% goes towards the Housing Whitefish Fund, which is so important because that fund is there to help pay the rents for the people who want to live and work here. These are people that are making less than $40,000 a year, and they want to live in town, they work in town, and they just can't afford the fact that their rent went up to $2,300. So out of that fund, if they can be subsidized a $500 or $600 check that goes towards their rent, then they can afford to stay here and live here and work here, which is great for us business owners. So I just really think it's important for, yes, you can have that 1% removed. And I ask that people really consider the fact that you're paying into something very valuable for your neighbors. I think it was last October that it was $83,000 contributed to that fund.
Wow.
Just from that 0.5%. And I think that was just half a year. Actually, I'm not sure. Don't quote me on that. I just remember the check being $83,000, which is just, you know.
That's
healthy.
That is very healthy.
Yes.
I'm going to have, is it Julie?
Julie Mullins.
I'll have to have Julie on. I've talked to her a couple times.
She's a much better speaker on this than I am.
Yeah.
But she's been misunderstood. She's been abused by people.
Yeah. I remember that came out. That really, people were really fired up about that.
People get really fired up about things that they don't fully understand, too. And I'm not saying that that's the reason why they got fired up. Her budget is extraordinarily tiny. Mm. So that other half a percentage that goes towards what she does to manage the number of people coming in during the summertime and hope, and again, spreading it out is very important. Mm. And her campaign is respect the fish. So when I say that it's pristine here, they're the ones that write the literature and put up the PSAs online that say, if you're going to visit here, please clean up after yourself. Please make sure you bring your bear spray. Please make sure that, you know, you pick up trash when you see it. Mm-hmm. You know, keep this place beautiful. That's what they, so I don't mind paying that 1%. And I hope a lot of people don't mind paying that 1%. And I encourage other restaurants. I know you asked about competition. No competition. But I am putting a challenge to other restaurants and maybe even retailers to be open to this 1% to help their community. I think it's a tremendous benefit.
Oh, that's amazing. I think that's what's kind of exciting, why I'm excited, you know, had Daniel Sitter on from Housing Whitefish.
That's great.
Hearing what they're doing is just amazing. We've got like the Rotary Club, like they do amazing stuff. It's really incredible to see how much this community does contribute to itself.
Yeah.
It's pretty exciting. And I think you're right. Like using Whitefish in the Flathead Valley as a litmus test that hopefully will spark the next generation to take what they grew up with and take it to the city or wherever they're going to go. And I think that's what makes me hopeful for our future. So long as we don't go into nuclear war or anything stupid, you know.
I know. I try not to think about the things I cannot control.
Yeah.
I really just focus my time on the things that I can, although I am guilty of doom scrolling from time to time, especially as it relates to women's rights and privacy and reproductive rights and all that other stuff.
You know? Right.
I did host a very large rally in 2021 in October for that reason. And
that was amazing.
I'll probably continue to do stuff like that.
Are you going to do that again? Because that was the biggest rally I have ever seen in this town. That was so well organized and so fun.
We did it in 10 days.
Oh, it was amazing. It was electric.
It was important and weird.
Yeah.
Because it, Roe fell.
And, oh, I know.
And that, just, yeah.
I mean, that was pretty defeating. So what's next? Like, do you have anything that you want to do next? Like, especially because Montana has interesting abortion rules
in our constitution. Enshrined in our constitution under a privacy.
Yeah.
Be careful who we're voting for.
Right.
And do not vote against your own interests. Be thoughtful about that. You know, how will this affect you and how will it affect your children? How will it affect your health care? How will it affect the thing that I do not no longer have, which is your privacy. I mean, we want our privacy. I still want my privacy. Mm-hmm. But it does affect a lot of those things. And if we're not careful, a very slippery slope is before us. I'd rather climb and build on what we have and help people become more aware. So yeah, I'll probably be part of some rally in the future, especially as we move towards election season. So I'm looking for people that are willing to, you know, do some of this work. It's not going to be right away, but yeah, for sure. This is important stuff.
Is there, if someone wanted to say like, hey, I want to volunteer or work with some of your organizations, is there like a good way to get hold of you or reach out to any of your organizations or to be in touch or to follow what you're doing?
Right now, volunteering is with Two Bear Therapeutic Writing Center. I know they do take on volunteers. But no, otherwise, the work in a lot of our other organizations are, you know, paid for work. And don't call me.
Yeah.
I won't be answering. But yeah, there's, gosh, I don't even know where I would point people.
Yeah. I guess like if you're interested in, if you've got experience with helicopters, they can reach out to Tube Air.
Yeah.
Air. But I know that's like, that's hard to, that's definitely such a sophisticated organization technically. But the fact that we've got people that can do what they do through Tube Air is pretty incredible, because yeah. I've seen the demonstrations and what happens in that hangar to prepare. And that is like serious rescuing operation.
They take it extraordinarily seriously. If those guys get start slipping up and cutting corners, you know, at the end of the day, it's their lives that are on the line. So they have to take it very seriously. And then you save lives that way, including your own. But yeah, in all of our organizations in which we have people, and Tube Air Air Rescue does have volunteers, although I think we've moved more towards paying salaries for those rescue specialists. But I love that we have very low turnover, you know, what a time saver, lifesaver. But, you know, you treat people right and make sure their needs are met, be thoughtful and collaborative, you're going to get people that want to stay with you. So that's really cool.
Oh, well, Jamie, thank you so much for coming on the show today.
Thank you so much for having me. It's a pleasure. And I love the work you do.
Oh, thank you.
It's important.
It is. It's important we have these big conversations and really talk them out so people can hear what's going on and not just get their information from comment sections on social media.
Right. It's so true. Although I do sometimes comment.
Oh, yeah.
Too much.
But I do too.
Whatever. It's just because, you know.
It's the tabloids of the modern day.
Yeah. And, you know, I just feel like hopefully I can reduce the assumptions people make about me and hear it directly from me. So that's what this is for. And
totally.
While I'll always comment.
Well, I loved this conversation. Thank you so much for taking the time.
Thank you too.